Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Coldwater by Jeff Rovin, narrated by Danny Campbell. Prologue. Exciting. That was the one word Rick Samuels thought he'd be using a lot when he took this job. On the home stretch of his senior year, at the annual job fair in the halls of Clareton High, Samuels felt it was amazing that he was seriously being scouted by what he thought was the high-prestige Nuclear Regulatory Commission, scouted for a ridiculously high-paying job, and right here in town. He was wrong. The job was anything but exciting. But the two most important things he'd sought, the serious scouting and the high-salaried job, were on the money. A joke he beat to death when he told his parents, his girlfriend, and everyone else in his circle. Big deal, he told himself about the rest of the job. A little truth fudging caused no harm and no foul. Okay, so his employers turned out not to be the NRC, but he was still able to give his girlfriend the NRC pamphlet they had given him. Nuclear power plant licensing basis for seismic hazards, which was seriously impressive, and backed up his contention that he was making the world a safer, better place to live. That excited her to no end. As for his parents, no amount of hindsight could shake them from their core understanding that their unfocused, unambitious, video game junkie son, who they were worried wouldn't even get into a community college, was going to collect $20 an hour, get health coverage to boot, and would no longer be living at home. Once that truth sank in, they didn't care if those perks were for running Viagra over the Canadian border. Thankfully, the other facts weren't too far off. He wasn't working for the NRC, but he was working for their good friends, the Consolidated Power Corporation. He even got to wear a nifty CPC shirt. And no, he wasn't exactly working in town, which was another white lie. He was assigned to a small but pleasant, fairly well-equipped blockhouse nestled in a valley stuck between the Yakima River and the Horn Rapids, east of West Richland, Washington, close enough to visit, which was all that really mattered. He did get to visit the impressive CPC corporate headquarters in Benton City to sign his employment papers, however, and there he was informed that his partner and immediate superior would detail his job when he came into work the following Monday. The following Monday, Rick was dazzled by the modern-seeming equipment in the plain but plush blockhouse, and also seduced by the bucolic setting that surrounded it. His folks, giddy with relief, had co-signed a lease on a new Toyota Corolla for his commute, and he was a little giddy himself to see it parked in the second of two spaces outside the office. The space had the name Richard Samuels stenciled emphatically in black on the concrete wedge between the asphalt and the blockhouse's gray wall. Rick wore his CPC shirt that first day. His superior, lately of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in La Cañada, Flint Ridge, California, did not. Professor Bernard Dumas looked like what Rick's parents would have labeled a hippie. He had longish, unkempt, but thankfully clean hair, thick, wire-rimmed glasses, a full beard, and remarkable, piercing eyes that seemed to glow like coals. He wore a plain black shirt, slacks, and shoes, as well as a lab coat. He gave the sudden, striking first impression of a loose cannon, but his smile was so genuine and disarming that Rick felt remarkably at ease. Even Dumas' sardonic explanation of the job didn't faze him, despite the man's many muttered, muted editorial comments. "The geniuses at Consolidated Power, apt name that, decided in their wisdom to open their new power plant surprisingly close to a major geological fault line," Dumas told Samuels as he walked him slowly around the blockhouse's just-finished interior. "I'm sure they know what they're doing," Rick said loyally. To which Dumas replied with one of his barely audible mutterings while he gestured lackadaisically at their surroundings. There was a bathroom, a kitchenette, a surprising number of vending machines for just two people, and a workspace dotted with consoles, seismographs, and desktop computer towers. When that sort of foolishness occurs, Dumas continued thoughtfully in his normal voice, the company feels duty-bound to open up a seismographic office to constantly monitor the comings and goings of the ground beneath our feet, and to appease the funding gods. The two had arrived at Samuel Station, fronted by a constantly active screen that looked like a cross between a heart monitor and an air traffic controller's display. It was flanked by both a digital and an old-fashioned seismic data acquisition system that looked like a lie detector test. Dumas smiled upon the latter and gave it a loving pat. They didn't want to include old Yeller here, he said wistfully. But she's always done right by me. Dumas shifted his disarming, trustworthy smile from the machine to Samuel's face. So, there we are. My job is to analyze the data. Your job is to collect it. And from that point forward, collect it is what Rick did. For the first few months, maybe even the first year, he took the work very seriously. Every blip, every slight change, every unusual manifestation was spotted as if stuck with a rapier. Rick wasn't only collecting $20 an hour. He had the safety of his parents, girlfriend, and hell, all humankind on his shoulders. But each blip, change, and manifestation resulted in just a shrug and a nod from Dumas, and the inspection visits from headquarters grew increasingly rare. Rick soon realized that the comings and goings of the ground beneath them were like a Rorschach test. The content seemed to change depending on the day and the viewer, but the overall design actually stayed the same. Within 2 years, Rick came to find their other responsibility, compiling a newsletter for the company and its shareholders to be a welcome change in the monotony. Its grand title amused Professor Dumas no end. The Yakima Horn Seismic Detention Office Report on Geological Change and Its Effect on Public Safety. But even that minor diversion kept being pulled away from Rick. As the days, weeks, months, and years droned on with only the slightest of superficial changes, the demand for the report became less and less urgent. It started as a weekly pamphlet, then became monthly, then bimonthly, then quarterly, then biannually, and finally yearly. Why don't they just email it at this point? Rick wondered aloud. Like most officious material of an ultra-low level, Dumas informed him sagely. It is the last to be recognized and the first to be downsized. Rick looked around him and had to agree. It was more than just the newsletter. His Corolla, the computer towers, and even old Yeller were simply 7 years longer in the tooth. Nothing had changed but his waistline. Those vending machines were insidious. Where had the time gone? How had the hoped-for opportunities simply stagnated? But every time he thought about chucking it all, he couldn't figure out anything else he really wanted to do. And the raises, smaller and smaller though they might be, just kept coming. He had long ago rationalized the entire thing as a ridiculously slow-moving video game that he kept at in the vain hope of someday winning. Even the collection of material for the dying newsletter held no interest for him anymore. He used to find it fascinating. Now it was just tedious data. He could tell depression was setting in when he offered to stay put while Bernie brought this year's pamphlets to the post office in Richland. Rick used to jump at the chance to get out of the blockhouse. Now he just wanted to wallow in it, like a lukewarm bath you're just too lazy to get out of. Are you sure you don't want to go? Dumas had asked solicitously, holding the box of pamphlets in the open door. Yeah, said Samuels, hardly glancing at him. It's okay, I'm good. It was a shame they both couldn't go, but someone had to be on the machines during working hours. That rule, like so many others, really didn't make sense. But those high school scouts had chosen Rick well. There was something about him that said, I follow orders. Dumas shrugged, but his smile stayed constant. I'll get you one of those coffee thingies you like, he said, and left without waiting for a response. Rick hardly noticed his departure. The door had barely closed after the man when Rick pulled out a drawing pad from his briefcase. In the last few months, the constantly shifting but never really changing screens had inspired him to start drawing. He was further inspired by his father's collection of old books, whose covers had some really wild and interesting paintings on them. Rick wouldn't know a Pollock from a Picasso, but he knew what he liked, and he liked colorful stripes and dots. Even if Dumas had pointed out the similarities between what was on the screens in front of him and what was on the paper beneath Rick's fingers, he might not have seen it. But he was so intent on his new hobby, he didn't notice much of anything. Not even when the monitors stayed the same, but old Yeller's previously steady arm started swinging wildly back and forth. It took a few seconds for Rick to notice anything out of the ordinary. At first he thought the strange scratching sound was coming from his own pencils. But then he realized the sound was a lot faster than his hands were moving. He stopped drawing. He glanced at the monitor inches from his face. No change. But the scratching sound continued just as quickly. Rick straightened up and looked to his right. The vending machines glowed in their wasted calorie way, with no sign of any breakdown. Rick frowned. He shrugged, then glanced to his left as he started to return to his drawing. He noticed Old Yeller's arm. It was as if Old Yeller leaped directly into his face, although it never moved. Reflexively, his fingers grabbed the lip of the console as if clamping onto a life preserver. His face snapped back toward the monitors and digital seismic machines. Nothing. 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 But Old Yeller was yelling, and its arm would brook no denial. Rick's smartphone jumped into his hand seemingly of its own accord, and his thumb was punching the numbers almost before he thought of them. As he did, all the screens started moving, and not in blips or slight changes either. It was as if the entire blockhouse had become a maniacally moving abstract painting. 30 miles away in Richland's quaint, near-empty, old-fashioned post office, Dumas' smartphone played the Grateful Dead's Trucking. Dumas placed the box of pamphlets down on the worn wooden counter and glanced at the postmaster, who had probably been there from the beginning of the Pony Express. Only now he was dodging downsizing rather than desperados. "Can I put this here a second, Frank?" Dumas asked politely. "Take all the seconds you need," said the old man, and went back to quickly and expertly sorting the day's mail into the dozens of boxes on the far wall. People might prefer email, but junk mail never rested. Dumas smiled at the man's dedication and brought up his phone. When he saw who was calling him, his smile faded for the first time in years. Professor Bernard Nigel Dumas was not a credulous man. He knew there was only one reason why Richard Samuels would be calling him, and it was not to change the order of his coffee thingy. Dumas pressed the green button on the glass face and stuck his smartphone tightly against his ear as if he had been waiting for this call for years. Because he had. "Yes, Rick?"
"Bernie? Bernie? It's the Ring of Fire. Oh my God, this is it. It's the Ring of Fire."
Even Frank heard what Rick was barking like a guard dog. The old postmaster turned with a look of concern. Dumas opened his mouth to calm his associate down, but then a strange fluttering distracted him. Frank didn't want to turn away from the galvanizing words either, but suddenly it felt like butterflies and birds were pelting him on the head and shoulders. The two men turned toward the post office wall to see every single envelope slithering, bouncing, and jerking out of the boxes as if they were coming alive. Then the roof fell in. Hannah Lonnegin knew what it was as soon as her vinyl records shifted from leaning right in their stacked milk crates to leaning left. The first time it happened, she had been totally perplexed, then totally freaked out. But after 3 years in L.A., it had become part of the scene. Even her cat Zanzibar was beginning to take the tremors in stride. She used to react as if a row of fight dogs was lining up before her. She would turn into a screeching, snarling Halloween caricature. This time, she merely meowed and shot under the bed. But Hannah's boyfriend, just back from college on the East Coast, was more shaken, literally.
"What's going on?" he bleated. "What is that?"
Hannah smiled benignly and uncurled from the trembling bed in her T-shirt and gym shorts.
"Just an earthquake, Josh," she informed him lightly. "You'll get used to them."
She gazed benevolently upon the handsome young man from the rich Idaho family in his T-shirt and jeans, and motioned for him to join her in the doorway. As he approached, she wrapped her arms around his waist and smiled up at him as only a freckled, green-eyed redhead could.
"You might even get to enjoy them," she said warmly, going up on her tippy-toes to give him a reassuring kiss.
But then, unlike the last few times, the shaking didn't stop. They found themselves holding each other even tighter.
"It's okay," she said in anything but certain terms.
"It happens a lot. It'll pass."
But it didn't.
Hannah remembered what her mother had told her when she was about to move out to California. Her mother, who had never lived in a seismically active zone.
"If there's an earthquake, stay under a door frame. That's the strongest, safest place in a building."
What if that was an old wives' tale? Wouldn't the strongest place be an interior wall with weight-bearing studs?
No. Not if the roof caved in.
Crap. Why hadn't she checked before this? Hannah flattened her hands on Josh's strong back, determined to be reassuring. She looked up into his eyes, but when she saw the anxiety, even fear there, all thought left her. Her hands sprang to his chest, and her mouth opened, but nothing came out. He opened his mouth in return and started to speak, but then the shaking slowed. The couple froze, hoping that it would continue to slow, but it did not. Instead, they both felt like they were standing on a wide, thick rubber band that was being stretched. And both intuitively knew what would happen once that rubber band snapped.
"Josh, I..."
She managed to get out before she heard a screech. Her head turned in the direction of an animal cry. Zanzibar bolted from under the bed as if shot from a cannon. The cat went right by Hannah's face and disappeared out the window. Then the doorway cracked in two, half of it slamming down and crushing Josh like a watermelon under a sledgehammer.
1. Region 9.
General J.C. Passarellis's words had come back to haunt all of them. As Wes Harding looked down through the helicopter windshield on the devastation that had once been Los Angeles, he could clearly remember every word of the speech the general had given only 6 months before in the nation's capital.
"When a grade 5 earthquake finally hits,"
Passarellis had solemnly told the FEMA Incident Workforce Academy graduates.
"And make no mistake, it will. The destruction will be beyond the imagination of each and every one of you."
The general was a squat, wide bulldozer of a man with a head like an Easter Island statue. From icy eyes within that stony brow, he glanced at the graduate's nurturing, understanding mentor, teacher, and boss, Dr. Thomas Malloy. Then he scanned the eager, determined young men and women sitting in the plain, square conference room in the monolithic headquarters of the Federal Emergency Management Agency in Washington, D.C. Wes thought that the general looked particularly hard and particularly long at his own blue eyes, but he might have been mistaken.
"You all know what earthquakes are," the general went on. "Hell, it is right there in the name, is it not? But how many of you know, truly know, the damage an earthquake can wreak?"
Each of the grads looked from Passarellis to Malloy and then to one another. They'd all had briefings, but they were unsure whether to respond or if it was a rhetorical question. Thankfully, the general took the decision out of their hands. Turning sharply, the military man nodded at the blank screen that took up most of the wall behind him.
"Although earthquakes can occur anywhere on Earth," he reminded them, "the majority of them occur at plate boundaries. They are known as interplate earthquakes."
As if the wall itself both respected and feared the man, the image of a map instantly appeared via PowerPoint magic. The image was an area they all knew well. A thick red line that traced the east coast of Australia up the various Asian coastlines, across the Pacific Ocean, and down the west side of the Americas. The general identified it out loud at the same time all the young officers were thinking it.
"The Ring of Fire," he intoned. 25,000 horseshoe-shaped miles of nearly continuous oceanic trenches, volcanic belts, and seismic plates. Home to more than 75% of the world's volcanoes and 90% of the world's earthquakes. That is 9-0, people. When the big one happens, it will happen here.
The general's tone became even more serious.
"But what is it? You," he said to a grad to his immediate right. "What will happen in the Philippines?"
The young man stammered for only a moment before Passarellas snapped at him.
"What happens when earthquake intensities are particularly strong?"
Liquefaction can occur?" the grad finally stammered.
"Yes."
Passarellas smiled like a shark.
"Soft sediments can actually undergo liquefaction, a phenomenon that occurs when wet sediments amplify seismic waves. The ground literally behaves like water, and the string of islands known as the Philippines could disappear as if they had never existed."
Wes gave the faces of his fellow grads a quick survey. He could see that they were imagining the same thing he was. Frightened Filipinos, already paralyzed by the awful shaking, trapped by suddenly rising waters, unable to do anything or go anywhere as the sea swallowed them. Passarellas' head snapped to the grad closest to him on the left.
"Japan," he barked.
"There are more than 85 active volcanoes in Japan," the grad responded, suitably shaken given the subject. "A powerful earthquake could cause a chain reaction."
"As well as," the general prompted, his eyes veiled, his lips in a mirthless grin.
"As well as tsunamis," said another grad. "The 2011 Fukushima earthquake was 6.6 magnitude. If it were even more powerful..."
"Landslides, mudslides, rocks raining down like missiles," the general told them flatly. "Japan would cave in on itself. The folks who were rendered unconscious or dead before being buried would be the lucky ones."
He took a moment to gaze upward.
"Let me put this in a context that some of our slower personnel will understand."
The eyes narrowed and came down like twin turrets firing.
"It would make Godzilla seem like a summer shower."
He ignored the uncomfortable rustling that rippled through the room.
"Iceland," he said, giving a little wave as if whipping the air. "Most sparsely populated country in Europe. Who cares what happens there?"
The grads couldn't tell if he was being sarcastic or not.
"Let us get a little closer to home, shall we?"
He turned on the farthest grad to the right, who, like the others, was rankling against the general's dismissal of an entire country.
"Alaska,"
Passarellas demanded.
"Alaska," the young woman repeated stiffly. "One of the largest volcano chains in the world. There would be floods, tidal waves, lava, landslides. Everything you said before."
"And?"
Passarellas pressed.
"And?"
the grad echoed, wide-eyed and helpless.
"And?"
the general repeated before looking at each of them again, his expression disappointed.
"I told you. Beyond your imaginations."
He stared accusingly at Doc Malloy.
"Quite possibly beyond your education."
Malloy held Passarellas' stare, but he also came to the rescue of his students.
"What do we think of when we think Alaska, people?" he asked.
The rankling turned to disappointed fidgeting as the grads searched their already addled brains for the answer.
"Dog races?" one offered weakly.
"Moose?"
said another softly. That's when Wes got it.
"Oil," he said. "We get almost 10% of our oil from Alaska."
The smile Passarellas pinned Wes with was more accusing than congratulatory.
"Yes," he said. "And what are the limits of your imagination, young man?"
"Go on." Wes did not cower. He was the son of a college football coach. He felt that in this case, the signal calling had been left up to him. "Not only would we lose precious fuel, the recovery process would be extremely challenging," he stated matter-of-factly. The effect of the leaked toxins on the environment would be equally catastrophic. There would be aftershocks. Mountainous terrain would be compromised in ways not immediately discernible. He noted Malloy's encouraging, thankful look before Passarellis's grim delight reclaimed his attention. The bond between the young man and the scientist had been strong from the moment they met. Wes was the son Malloy didn't have, and Malloy was the kind of laid-back adult Wes had never known.
"Good," the general said, stepping from behind the podium in Wes's direction.
Passarellis saw what everyone did. A short, fit, tousle-haired, blonde, blue-eyed country boy who might look more at home by a haystack than a hovercraft. One who, like the barnstormers of a bygone age, wanted to swap ground for sky, clouds of wheat for real clouds. Passarellis looked like he was going to shred him.
"Very good," the general continued smoothly. "Seems we have someone who can think outside the pipelines."
No one dared chuckle at the general's play on words.
"Let us continue with you for the best part, shall we?"
He stared intently at Wes.
"Region 9,
he said with bleak relish, naming one of the Bureau's 10 regional centers.
"What will happen in Region 9?
Wes came from Ventura County, which was well within the borders of FEMA's Region 9. Their headquarters in Oakland, California, was responsible for the rest of the state, as well as Arizona, Nevada, Hawaii, Guam, American Samoa, the Commonwealth of Northern Mariana Islands, the Republic of the Marshall Islands, the Federated States of Micronesia, and more than 150 sovereign tribal entities. Wes felt his throat threaten to close up. He straightened his neck with a tiny click and inhaled, preparing. They weren't talking about theories and strangers now. Wes was about to describe the devastation that would hit not only the region, but his home, his family, his friends. "Roads would buckle," he said. "Buildings would crack. Electric lines would snap. Gas mains would rupture. Dams would break. Everything you mentioned before, sir. Landslides, mudslides, tidal waves. All of that would happen. And then combine."
"Combine."
The general's voice was both urgent and empty. "Electric lines would set off gas leaks. Explosions and fires would be endemic. Cars and trucks would slam into buildings and pedestrians. Buildings would smash other buildings like dominoes. Homes would disintegrate like matchbox models. Entire canyons would roll like tidal waves. Valleys would twist like they were in blenders. Seas of sewage would cover everything. Those not killed in the natural disasters could die of disease. L.A. would look like the far side of the moon." Wes's statement hung in the air like a noose. The voice of Doc Malloy came in with stentorian tones. "And the seventh plague would be the reign of our decadence. Window-placed air conditioners, satellite dishes, and rooftop chaises of ex-sunbathers." Their superior's interruption, blackly humorous as it was, managed to break the doomsday mood. But then something happened that Wes would never forget. Passarellis, seemingly angered by Malloy's desolate levity, placed his fists on the podium and hunched his shoulders, lancing each of them again with his granite gaze.
"Mark it well, people. The Ring of Fire. And its bastard stepchild, the San Andreas Fault. Along these lines will come your personal trials by fire."
The statement jolted Wes as intended, but it also annoyed him. The general was underestimating all of them. "Everyone's aware that there will be blood in the streets," he spoke up. "Sir." He was expecting a backlash. Somehow the dead, dismissive glance the general gave him was worse. Then Passarellis simply looked away.
"And it might be yours," he stated to the group. "But no one is suggesting you waste your valuable time or psychological resources visualizing that."
Abruptly, the general changed topic and tone and began droning on about lithospheric plates and tectonics. But every graduate was busy thinking about where they might land in the thick red line from Alaska's Attu Island, far west in the Bering Sea, to the tip of Los Cabos in Baja California Sur. Afterward, they had all tried to laugh it off during a celebratory beer, but the image of that red horseshoe and the general's warning took up residence in their minds like a squatter. But not for long. Less than 6 months later, it happened, seemingly all at once. Antarctica, New Zealand, Indonesia, the Philippines, Japan, Russia, Canada, Alaska, California, Chile, Bolivia, Costa Rica. As if the ring of fire had snapped like a bullwhip. Einstein said that God doesn't play dice with the world. The voice of the pilot, Charlie Dewey, interrupted Wes's gaze over Los Angeles. Looking at that down there, I wonder if he would change his mind about that. The young Navy man's wisecrack slipped into Wes's ears through noise-canceling headphones. Given the rush of the wind and the hushed growl of the S-99 utility helicopter's twin turboshaft engines and four-bladed rotors, it would have been the only way Wes could hear him. Wes couldn't disagree with the wiry African-American pilot's description. They were staring at the grim wreckage of hundreds of thousands of buildings below them. Some structures of Los Angeles were still vaguely recognizable, but they were universally tumbled and torn. "More like Satan stepped on it, Charlie," Wes replied. "Some truth in that," the pilot answered. Wes scanned the distance, the sea looking as it always had, untouched by the disaster on land, the surrounding bowl of California almost green in places. But he knew part of that image was only through the lens of memory. Most of the actually visible panorama was filled with a veil of rising toxic steam. Some of it was from pipes no one could close. Some of it from vents rooted deep inside the earth. All of it blended into a yellowish miasma worse than the smog of the old L.A. Despite the fact that they had been trained in two different places by two different organizations, Wes and Charlie Dewey had both been taught not to get too emotional. To be sympathetic but not empathetic. To be like the lifeguard who saves the drowning without getting pulled down. But Wes wondered whether the job of literally staying in the air made it easier for Charlie to remember his training. His own job demanded internal role-playing, imagining himself into people's lives on the ground so he could find ways to improve them. As Wes surveyed the scene, he acknowledged that everything Passarellas had predicted less than a year ago in that D.C. meeting room had come to pass. The Los Angeles basin had collapsed like a Lego set dropped into the La Brea tar pits. Wes focused on the Culver City clock that was now leaning over Washington Boulevard, its once proud face covered in slime and mold, its hands frozen forever on the time everything ended. "How long has it been?" Wes recalled. "Only 43 days. The scope of the devastation was impossible to imagine, even for people acclimatized by media-touted disasters like Hurricanes Katrina and Sandy and the Fukushima nuclear meltdown. Dozens of countries had been affected. Over 1 million people had died. "I keep thinking it's a movie set," Charlie muttered, scanning the rubble half-submerged in fetid water. "If only, right? Get in your car and drive on out?" "Considering what we're up against," Wes absently replied. "We're doing okay." "Yeah, I'm feeling real successful about now," Dewey said, bluffing with cynicism. "The Navy had me jumping through hoops, and shooting at hoops, but they didn't get me ready for this." "There was no way they could," Wes said to him. "There could never be enough earthquake and terror drills to prep for a real disaster. You just have to live it." The pilot nodded once and pursed his lips. Wes studied the weed-covered ruptures marked with neon circles, numbers, and crosses that his fellow assessors had made. "We're doing better than the poor bastards down there, anyway," Wes observed, not with detachment, but with sadness. The ring of fire had left an ugly scar on the face of the earth, not just physically, but emotionally. The coasts of western Canada, Chile, New Zealand suffered. The inlands sympathized. The United Nations, the Red Cross, and FEMA had banded together with an uncommon spirit of cooperation to help the survivors. The rest of the world seemed to give silent thanks it wasn't them, and went about their business, while donating every spare dollar, euro, peso, ruble, rupia, yen, cologne, and boliviano they could.
"Good thing we got a strong hand on the stick," Charlie remarked. "If we were still running ops under old heck of a job Brownie, we'd be up the proverbial creek without the proverbial paddle."
Wes rolled his eyes at the thought of the unit's previous leader, who was legendary for all the wrong reasons. He was the kind of inertia-bound bureaucrat who gave run-of-the-mill bureaucrats a bad name. 48 hours after the Ring of Fire blew up, he was moved from the field to Washington, D.C., where he now appeared in photos beside cargo planes that were coming and going as part of global relief efforts. General Passarellas had taken his place in Region 9. Charlie peered through the clouds of still-swirling ash to spot any sign of the landing pad. Maneuvering through the dust of concrete, steel, glass, gypsum, lead, mercury, dioxins, and even asbestos was worse than navigating an Afghan sandstorm.
"What sort of name is Passarellas, anyway?"
the pilot wondered absently, eyes intent below him. Wes vaguely heard him while concentrating on his clipboard. "Initial back check," he read his notes to himself. "May 24th. Grid 213, line 4. Baldwin Avenue as marked. 249 Baldwin. Two fatalities. Survivor reports husband missing. Last name, McGinnis. 251 Baldwin. Six fatalities. Survivor reports father missing. Last name, Calloway. 253 Baldwin.
Sounds French," Wes answered. Charlie snorted. "Sounds like a cheap trophy."
"Doesn't matter.
He's the president's golden boy now. Had the fastest promotion track in military history, and not even West Point. What's the JC stand for?"
Wes looked up, his expression slightly troubled.
"I don't know," he realized.
"I don't think anyone does."
"Bada bing," Charlie jumped in. "There it is."
Wes looked where the pilot was pointing and brightened as the clouds of carcinogens opened up to reveal East 101, the camp where the top FEMA and Ring of Fire military personnel had set up their base. It was fenced on three sides to keep looters out and the registered populace in, so that bored or desperate camp dwellers wouldn't wander into treacherous landscape. The fourth side of the camp was the sagging retaining wall of Route East 101, which held hundreds of dead flowers, pictures, flags, and flyers. As always, a long line of survivors shuffled along it, being checked, evaluated, categorized, and assigned to either a combat support hospital, rest barrack, or evac chopper. The people in the line coughed as dust rose and spun toward the helicopter, but no one looked up. Choppers had replaced cars as the background of L.A.
"Sorry, folks," Wes murmured. "One of these days we'll get you surgical masks."
Their landing pattern also revealed Route 101's west wall, and Wes shook his head as he gazed at it. The wall was also a giant memorial, but it was much more stark and macabre. There was no color anywhere along it, just black paint covering it with names of the dead, dates of the dead, and the symbols of their gods. It stretched as far as Wes could see. The survivors called it Wall X. The X stood for Exhumed. The sight of it caused the long day to settle squarely on his shoulders. So much death. So much destruction. Charlie took a sec away from his landing protocol to note his friend's expression. He understood immediately.
"Could be worse," he said encouragingly. "Could have been aftershocks. Looks like we dodged a bullet on that one."
"So far," Wes replied. The chopper settled to the ground. As always, Wes marveled at Charlie's ability to thread the needle between so many other copters. All the pilots seemed to treat their whirlybirds like tractor trailers at interstate rest stops after midnight, lining them up unscratched in almost impossibly small spaces. The two young men descended from the relative peace and quiet of the air and headphones to barely controlled noisy chaos on the ground. Before Wes could thank Charlie, the pilot vaulted out of the cockpit, like a horizontal bar gymnast. His modus operandi had always been to appear only when it was flying time, then make himself scarce.
"Learn that the hard way,"
he had told Wes 40 days ago. "You're standing around, people treat you like you're a greeter or a gopher." Wes, on the other hand, missed not only Charlie's attitude, but also his solid presence. Everyone else seemed to be reenacting Pamplona's running of the bulls. As Wes searched through the crowd for his boss, his pace hastened to match the urgency of the crowd. Navy pilots were scurrying around their copters. Shell-shock survivors were shuffling in quickstep like workers marching on a chain gang. Local police and firemen circled the area like cowboys looking for stragglers on a cattle drive. Then there was Passarellas and his posse. He stood by the open door of a sea stallion rescue chopper, looking much the same as he had during the graduation ceremony. Only now there were many more shiny things on his shoulders, sleeves, and chest. At FEMA, he had carried himself like a vulture looking for a victim. Now he looked like a lion leading his pride, or Patton, about to have Rommel for lunch. There were many more people around him as well. Since he was given the assignment of heading the Region 9 recovery on a silver platter, Passarellas had created his own personal team of highly trained, highly motivated, highly loyal men. "No women in his posse," Charlie had mentioned to Wes weeks ago. "I heard every guy on the team washed out of the SEALs, Delta, or Special Forces. And now they've got all kinds of need to prove themselves. Chips on their shoulders the size of trees." It would be tough to tell who was who, since they all wore visored headgear and special black uniforms at all times, complete with Passarellas' personally designed ring of fire patch on their upper arms. It pictured a literal ring of fire inside a no symbol, a circle with a diagonal line through it.
"These guys look like an army of ubermenches to me," Charlie had commented. "Nietzsche would be proud."
Leave it to the college-educated Dewey, the son of a pair of UCLA language professors, to invoke the name of a philosophical poster child to describe Passarellas' posse. Somehow the pilot had wrung a double major and a minor out of his NROTC scholarship at Cornell. But Wes couldn't disagree with Dewey as he looked at the black suits now, hovering on each of the general's words, their ubiquitous MP7 submachine guns at the ready. What did they have high-powered assault rifles for anyway? Wes wondered. And not for the first time. The only things to shoot out here were survivors and one another. As he had with so many other non-essential questions that had sprung to mind since the disaster, Wes pushed it to the back burner, to be pondered in the wee hours. He wanted to report to Malloy while the information was still fresh in his brain, and inevitably, wherever Passarellas was, Malloy wouldn't be far away. Sure enough, as Wes turned his head to the right, his FEMA boss appeared in his vision. Malloy looked older than his 50 years. He was standing beside another sea stallion, clipboard in hand. Rather than instructing his own select cadre of agents, Malloy was helping to evacuate a section of the survivor line. As Wes neared him, he noticed that, as usual, Malloy was dressed for a fishing trip or photographic safari in a khaki bush shirt, pants, vest, boots, and tilly hat.
"Is that a E or O, ma'am?"
Wes heard Malloy say hoarsely to the woman nearest the chopper's hatch.
"E."
"Very good," Malloy continued, checking his clipboard.
"You're being evac'd, Mrs. Jensen."
"I'm being what?" Malloy shook his head in self-deprecation and put a reassuring hand on the woman's arm.
"Sorry. Evacuated to Edwards Air Force Base. From there you'll be relocated according to where you have family or a preferred city or state to start your new life. It gets better from here, I promise."
At that moment, Malloy spied Wes, waved him over with relief, and handed his clipboard to an Air Force man beside him. As Malloy stepped forward and took Harding's elbow, Wes heard Mrs. Jensen cry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.